A few administrative announcements as we get started. First, I posted in the files section of Elms in a folder called Morgan Stanley Cat two files. So last week when Nicole from Morgan Stanley was here as a sell-side analyst, she did a PowerPoint. So the copy of her PowerPoint is here. The other copy is she sent me yesterday the analyst model that she created for Morgan Stanley when she evaluates CAT. So after the October 22nd earnings call, she updated the model. This is her most recent Excel model. She said that she would share it with the class. She emailed it to us yesterday. So if you were to open the file, you can enable the macros, but basically you can see all of the tabs here and how she does, for example, her valuation, how she does her multiples. And again, this is real. This is exactly what she is using to do her actual target price and valuation. So if you want to see how the real world actually does models, that there's actually a real world model available for you guys. So speaking of Morgan Stanley, again, she mentioned this in class, so I'll just remind you, Nicole is responsible for helping recruit potential people for Morgan Stanley. Her primary school is Penn/Wharton undergrads, but she said that if anybody, and she reminded me yesterday, if anybody's looking for a job, not just as an analyst, but also in investment banking, mergers and acquisition, fixed income, Morgan Stanley does a lot of things. I know they don't directly recruit here in Maryland, but if you want, she's happy to look at your resume and or pass it along. So remind her to do that, or if you want me to send it on your behalf, send me your resume, happy to put that out there. So second thing is I posted this on Friday, but again, company called PVH, Phil Van Heusen, which is Calvin Klein, Tommy Hilfiger, and a bunch of other brands. They are looking for somebody to basically be an analyst in Mexico City for 3 months as a intern. And they said they're willing to do somebody in the spring, either January, February through the spring, or somebody during the summer. But basically, you'd work on a multidisciplinary, multicultural team reporting directly to the VP of Finance. I know their head of Mexico. She's really interested in getting a student that could do some really cool stuff. So you'd be working on some real projects over that period of time. They're also looking to put together a scholarship as additional comp for anybody interested. So again, if you're interested in that, you have the email link online. I put a little demo video of who PVH is, and you're welcome to see me about that if you're interested. Final thing I want to mention is upcoming the BAT. So again, I put here on the announcement section information about the four BAT opportunities coming up in week after next in November. So a couple things. One, on November 9th, you can take it at 11 a.m. or 2 p.m. On November 11th, you can take it at 12:30 or 3:30. You can go to any one of those four sections. This will be the only extra credit that I'm offering this semester. So it's your option. You don't have to take it, but if you think you're going to need extra credit or you want extra credit, this is your opportunity for extra credit. So it's worth up to 5% of your semester grade. So you have two options. You can take it during one of the four times in this section or in this classroom, but this announcement was sent to the rest of the finance community in the Smith School as being circulated around the University of Maryland. So the time slots are open to anybody that wants to take it. If this room has more than 45 people in it, they'll start turning people away. So there's an opportunity on this page to register to say that I want to take the BAT during this time slot. Just letting you know that if you do want to take it during the BAT during class, it's in your interest to register. I'm not saying that we'll suddenly get this swarm of people, but I would hate to see that you come in here wanting to do it and there's a bunch of people sitting down and there's no room in this room for you to take the exam. So please register very quickly. Just click on the link, type in your name and email so that they know that you are one of the people that's going to be taking it during that time slot. If, however, you don't want to take it during that time slot or you can't, your second option is right here. You can register there's the limited seating, but you can register to take it online. You would use this promo code, UMDFall15, and you could take it for free online. Otherwise, we'd have to pay $35. And same thing, it's a two-hour timed exam. You could do it at your convenience. Now, you'd still have to do it by the end of next week or end of 2 weeks from now. So same time frame as everybody else. And remember, you'd have to do it at home, two-hour block, with a video camera, because they will listen to you and watch you on video while you take it to make sure that you're not collaborating or cheating in any way. But basically, you can choose that as an alternative. But those are your two options for taking the bat. Now, the final thing is that week of November 9th. One of the reasons I've chosen that is if you see I'm in a cast. It's been a horrible journey since my Segway accident. Segways are dangerous, just so you know, public service announcement. But I was on a Segway tour. But long story short, I'm going to have foot surgery. So it's actually going to be that week. That's one of the reasons why I chose the bat. And so what that means is we're not going to have physical class the week of November 9th and 11th. There will be assignments. There will be time to work on your group projects. But that's why I made it the bat week. So just a heads up for that. Okay? Questions about any of the things I just mentioned administratively? Yes?
Is there a limit on how many people can take it outside of the classroom on their computer?
I'm sure that Bloomberg will have a limit because I told them I have 160 total students. But, you know, I don't think so. I mean, I think if like 500 people showed up, Bloomberg might like cut it off, right? But the goal was for people that couldn't take it live to give them an alternative, right? But as I said, either choice, you can take it live, you can take it online. Other questions? All right, we have a lot to accomplish today. So, want to talk about multiples, want to talk about updating the model for valuation, and then I want to talk about your assignment that'll be due on Monday. Okay, so let's go ahead and get started. First, going back to where we left off, multiples. Yes? Can I turn on that screen? Oh, that screen's not on? It's kind of weird.
I'll try.
Let's see if that works. So, starting with multiples, there are six multiples that you're going to be responsible for calculating and evaluating this semester. They are, in no particular order, the price-to-earnings ratio, also known as the PE, price per share divided by earnings per share, the PEG ratio, which is the price-to-earnings ratio divided by the long-term growth rate in earnings per share, the three enterprise value ratios, enterprise value or EV to sales, EV to EBITDA, EV to EBIT, and finally the price to book multiple, PB. Okay, so when we do multiples, right, what's going to be important is that we use what's called forward multiples as opposed to historical multiples. So it's based on, valuation is based on expected cash flows, therefore we care more about expected earnings than historical earnings. Okay, so all of these numbers are based on expectations. That's why in order to do the multiples, you won't be able to do it with Yahoo Finance or Google Finance or any of the other free services because they don't give you forward data, and you will need forward data to do the forward multiples. Right? And specifically, what the book talked about in its reading is that the second forward year is the most normalized and the most important to the professionals. So that's what we're also going to be using when we go through this class, FY2 numbers, which I'll talk about in just a minute. So let's talk about multiples first. So when we go to Bloomberg, so I'm going to log into Bloomberg here, right? And what we're going to do is we'll start out with Caterpillar, which is where we're using as our sample company. We've done the valuation on Monday. What I want to do is I want to go get the multiple data out of Bloomberg and quickly compare it against its peers, right? So, first of all, just to get you a sense of when I say forward data, what I mean, if I go to the EEO screen, then you'll see, for CAD as an example, that where it says FY 2014 actual, this is the most recent reported year, forward year one, FY1, shortcut, is, or next year, or this year, sorry, is the FY 2015. So even though we're three quarters of the way through 2015, it's still considered the forward year one because it's not been reported yet. Okay, forward year two, you can count two columns over, is 2016. So that's next full year. Right? So typically, as I said, what we're going to focus on for multiples is going to be that next full year. So FY2, so two columns over. You can even see there's a difference in color between the numbers that are actually reported and the estimates for the next 2 years. Now, the multiples in our class are actually right here for FY2016. They're already calculated by Bloomberg, right? So that's one of the nice features of the data service. However, if we were comparing CAT, Komatsu, Joy Global, some of its peers, we'd have to go by company, we'd have to copy and paste all the data, put in Excel, and just it would take a lot of work. So here's how we're going to make our lives a lot easier. We are going to get these multiples for the peers to do our analysis off the RV screen. So go to RV, which is where we can quickly compare against peers. Then go to Custom and click on Create a Brand New Template. Okay. So as I said, there are six multiples that we will need to understand. We're going to take these six multiples and create a template in Bloomberg so that we can always fetch this data for these companies against their peers very quickly. So in Add Column, so here in the middle of the screen, we're going to start adding the multiples. So I'll start with the enterprise value multiples first. First, enterprise value to sales. So in the Add Column, you can type EV, or enterprise value, space TO, space sales. And you'll see that Bloomberg, because people use these a lot, already has two ratios created, EV to next year's estimated sales, EV to this year's estimated sales. This year, FY1, 2015. Next year, FY2, 2016. So the ratio we want is EV to next year estimated sales. That's what we would choose. Now I'm going to choose this in a second, but I'll tell you one other thing. You'll see something in here when you start doing searches called best. So EV to best sales. Best stands for Bloomberg estimate. Okay, so I could actually go into the best sales and then it will allow me to custom configure a date range. So it'll say year 0, year 0 plus 1, year 0 plus 2, and I could actually go in and manually create this. But since this is a pretty commonly used ratio, let's just, you know, use what's already there. So I want EV to next year's estimated sales. Select it, enter, it adds it to my list. Next, EV to EBITDA, same thing. In the column, EV space TO space EBITDA. And what I want, and there's a lot of them on here, so what I can do is I can click on Show More Matches. And if I scroll down, these are all the things that meet the search criteria. And I see mine here, EV to next year estimated EBITDA. Click on it, select it, it adds it. The third ratio, EV to EBIT, EV space TO space EBIT, and again, I could do a quick search, show more matches, because there's a lot of EBITs in there, and I'm looking for, where is it, EV to next year estimated EBIT, select it, and it's there. Right, those are the first three enterprise value ratios. The next one we're going to put in is called the price to earnings multiple. Add column, P/E for price to earnings, except what I want is my estimated PE for next year, forward PE for next year, 2016 PE. So let's go ahead and choose that one and hit enter. All right, the next ratio that we're going to look at is called the PEG ratio, PEG. So I can type in PEG, and you'll see that there's something called the best estimated PEG ratio. I want to choose that one, and I'll do it for the current year, all right? Because the PEG ratio is based on the 5-year long-term growth rate in earnings per share. So it's the PE ratio divided by the next 5 years' growth in earnings per share. So if I do the current year, it'll be the upcoming year and the next 4 years after that earnings per share, which is why we're using that one. Okay, that's the definition of long-term growth on Wall Street. They go out 5 years. All right, finally, we do the price to book multiple. So I just type in, I can type in price to book or P/B, and that's the price to book ratio. Click on that, Again, I want the current one, because the current price is all we're going to get. Don't really get a future price divided by current book value per share. So those are the six ratios we need in the template. Now, to help us, we are going to need that long-term growth rate that I just mentioned in earnings per share. So I'm going to add that to my template, knowing that we're going to use that in just a few minutes. So I'll come here to add column. I'll type in LTG, and I want my best LTG EPS. Okay, so that's my best long-term growth rate for earnings per share. And I want that as of one day ago, which means the most current analyst estimates for earnings per share growth for the next 5 years from yesterday. Okay, so I've created my template, and now I want to save it so I can reuse it. So what I'll do is I'll come here, and I'll click on Save As, and then I'll type in my name. So I'll call it 443 multiples, or whatever you want to name it, and then hit Save. Now, I already done this in the last class, so I'm going to overwrite it. Hit OK, and it will save the template and put it right here on the menu bar. Right? Now, the reason why that can be very useful is, let's say we were going to another company. Okay? So I go into Bloomberg. I'll just pop here to a different screen. So let's say I was doing Apple, which just announced earnings yesterday. So I go to AAPL, US Equity. I go to RV. I go to Custom. And then I click on the template that I just created. And that's the point. I then have all of the multiples for Apple and its peers immediately refreshed. Okay, so that's the nice time-saving feature of the RV screen. One last thing is make sure that in your settings for the RV screen, global settings, that you have the market cap weighted average box checked. Okay, that means every time you load it, it'll always put that market cap weighted average in there, because that will give us the idea of an industry multiple. Okay, because it's the weighted average based on size of all the companies on the list. And make sure that when you export, static data. Okay, so it'll give you numbers, not relative references. Because again, if you're not at a terminal and you don't have static data, every time you open up the exported Excel spreadsheet, it'll die. It'll say, I can't find anything. There's error out. Okay, so static data exports actual numbers. So just make sure that's your global setting. All right, so this is the template. This is the data. We're now going to start to analyze the data and see what kind of story it tells us about the company and the industry. And I'm going to go back to CAT for our analysis. Now, let's go back also to our PowerPoint. So, as we talked about at the end of class on Monday, the key value drivers formula is what's going to help us understand what's going on with these multiples. So, if we use the key value drivers formula, and this is just a table that represents this, and we plot it out, then basically this represents the results of putting data into the key value driver formula. Now, it assumes 100 of NOPLAT, 10% cost of capital, at different ROICs and different growth rates, this would be the dollar results of the key value driver formula in Excel. Okay? So, here's the point. What is an enterprise value to EBIT multiple really? Okay? So, here's the idea. If we have 100 of NOPLAT and the tax rate were 35%, we would have had 154 of EBIT. It's working backwards. Okay, 100 divided by 0.65 gets us 154. All right. So here's the next point. If I had these values from my key value driver formula result, and I divided it by the 154, then I would get these multiples. Okay. So remember that the key value driver formula is a function of three things. Right. Number one, I'll go back to our model in class that we had done back in September 2nd. It's a function of three things. It's a function of profit, growth, return, cost of capital. Okay, so primarily it's growth, return, cost of capital, growth, and spread that drive multiples. So let's go back to this. So here's the idea. Putting in the profit, putting in the growth, the return, the cost of capital got us these results divided by the profit, pre-tax profit, get us enterprise value to EBIT. Okay? So here's the real point. Company's trading at an enterprise value to EBIT of 7. Where do we see 7 on that table in the middle of the screen in the multiples of EBIT? Where do I see 7? All right, so I see it a 12% ROIC and a 3% growth. There's a 7. Where else do I see a 7? 2 and 14 is a 7. And somewhere between 1 and 2 and 16 is also a 7. So that's what I want you to start to understand about multiples. First, multiples are a representation of primarily growth and spread. And assuming similar cost of capitals, growth in ROIC by proxy, right? And second, it's based on forward data, so I don't know the actual numbers, but I generally know a range. All right, so that's the point, is that if somebody's trading at 7x EBIT, given a 10% cost of capital, I know that the growth rate is probably going to be somewhere in this range, and assuming that level of cost of capital, so somewhere between 1% and 3%, and somewhere between 12 and 16%. But flip it around. If somebody has relatively low single-digit growth, and their ROIC is 12 to 14%, they're going to probably trade somewhere around 7x EBITDA, all right, or EBIT in this case. Does that make sense? 5. Where's a 5 on this list? Where do I see 5s? Yep.
Somewhere between 2 and 3% when you have 6% ROIC.
Yep. And what if I had 8% ROIC?
4 and 5%.
Okay, so I'm in somewhere in this range. Almost draw a line. So tell me, just based on this table, what's the difference between a 5 and a 7? What could we ascertain if we saw a company trading at 5x EBIT versus 7x EBIT? All right, yeah, so what could we specifically tell? Which company has a positive spread? The 1-7. Which company has a negative spread? So that's the point. If a company's trading at a 5x multiple, given a level of cost of capital, then we would think that they probably have a negative spread. Expected forward. And the key word is expected negative spread, not current. This is all expectation. Where if a company was trading at 7 in the same industry for a similar cost of capital, they are probably expected to have a positive spread. So this is what I'm telling you, that when we do multiple analysis, it's not just is the company, you know, average out the multiples, how far is it from the mean, this is what they're going to trade at. No. They're going to trade at 7x because the underlying numbers say it's worth 7x EBIT. They're going to trade at 5x because it's worth, the underlying numbers say it's 5x EBIT. And it's really an expectation, expression of future growth, future spread, future return. Those are the primary drivers, particularly of enterprise value to EBIT. Now, continuing on, PE ratio. PE ratio is basically using the same key value drivers, except instead of NOPLAT, we plug in net income. Growth is the growth in earnings, not the growth in cash flows. Return on equity and cost of equity. Right? Those get me the PEs. Same concept, just using ROE as an example, right? Now, here's the thing I want you to understand about the PEs. The PEs are actually harder to explain, even though we're using the same key value drivers, than the enterprise value to EBIT. And here's why. EBIT stops with operating performance. When we get to PE, we have to add in taxes, we have to add in non-operating gains and losses, and we have to add in interest expense, which means impact of capital charges. So the PE multiple is a six-factor analysis, right? Because it's not only growth and spread, growth, ROIC, cost of capital. In addition, it can be more influenced because of accounting by tax rate, interest expense, capital structure, call it as a proxy, and non-operating gains and losses. So even though the PE is the easiest ratio for most people to comprehend, as the one that's most talked about, it's why I mentioned here, it's actually the hardest to explain because six things could make the PE higher or lower. It's not as clean as the enterprise value multiples. Right? That's why the pros tend to prefer the enterprise value multiples because they're just less subject to distortion. Not saying that any of these ratios can't be distorted, but they just tend to be a little bit less subject to distortion because they're based on the operating performance of the business. Yes?
So the difference between EBIT
EBIT and PE is the growth is net income for PE.
That's what I'm saying. It's the growth of the enterprise value to EBIT is the growth in the NOPLAT slash the growth in the EBIT. Whereas the PE ratio is the growth in the earnings per share. Okay, so same concept of growth, it's just a different growth. Okay, but the real key is, as I said, enterprise value to EBIT is going to be more based on the key value drivers, where PE is going to be affected by three additional things more. Okay, so I'm just saying that they'll generally tell you the same thing, but not always, because of these nuances, which we'll come back to in a minute. So here's the point. Using that key value drivers equation, plugging in net income, plugging in return on equity, plugging in cost of equity, and plugging in long-term growth rate and net income, growth in earnings per share, into the key value driver formula, we get these results, right? That then, divided by the net income, so let's say our net income is 100, cost of equity is 10%, different returns on equities, different growth rates, these would be the results of the key value driver formula, divided by 100, these would be the PE ratios, right? Now, there's a related ratio called price to book, right? Price to book is the price, the market value, divided by the book value of equity. So I want you to look at this column, and I want you to tell me what the difference is between a price to book of 1.3 and a price to book of 0.75. What does the price to book actually tell you? 1.3 versus 0.75. Yeah.
1.3 means the price that it's trading at right now is 1.3 times the book value.
All right, so it's trading at 1.3 times the book value of the asset, so it's trading at a premium. What would cause it to trade at a premium?
Higher
than what?
Higher
ROE, higher than what?
Higher than the 0.75.
It's not higher than, it's higher than the cost of capital. So price to book is the most pure ratio of spread. So a company with a price to book of 1 is a company with 0 spread. It's like 0 NPV. I earn my cost of capital, and you can see that right here. So if I have 0 spread, 10% return, 10% cost of equity, 10% cost of capital, then I have 0 NPV, IRR equals R, which means I've added no value, which means whatever I invested, that's exactly what it's worth, price to book of 1. So in order to have a price to book above 1, I have to have a positive spread. I got to have positive NPV. So that's the point. By looking at price to book, it can tell me whether or not a company is expected to have a positive spread in the future or a negative spread in the future. The 1.33 tells me it's a positive spread. And look at where 1.33 is on this table. 1.33 is an above 10% return at a positive growth rate. And again, it could be in a couple of different places, but the point is, I know it has a positive spread. Where's 0.75? It's in the negative spread side of the column, right? So let me play this out. So yesterday I was doing some work with Sumitomo Bank, one of the big mega banks of Japan, fairly senior group. I have to say, Japanese are very proud people. And I had to give them some news, right? You can infer based on where I'm going that the news was probably not positive. So I know we don't know a lot about banks, and I know we don't really talk about banks in the class, but let me just show you some data, and then you tell me what kind of news you think we should give Sumitomo Bank. So I go here. I go to Sumitomo, Tokyo, right? And then what I'll do is I'll go to the RV section, and I'll load our template, custom template, the multiples we just created. Look at the price to books of Sumitomo, and these are some of the other large banks in the world, but what's their price to book? Banks aren't going to have enterprise value ratios. That's why we're not going to do banks. But what's the price to book of Sumitomo? 0.72. So what do we know about Sumitomo? I'm sorry?
Negative.
Yeah, that they're expected to have a negative spread. Right? So here's the point. Why were they expected to have a negative spread? Well, I can go to the WACC screen, and I can see cost of equity, because I'm doing a PE ratio. Right now it's about 11.4%. Then I can go to the EEO screen, and I can quickly see that the expected return on equity, 8.6%, 8.3%, 8%, 7.7%. Right? Why Is Sumitomo trading below book value? Why are they worth more dead than alive? And the answer is because they have a negative spread. I knew that before I even saw the returns because I saw their price to book multiple. Oh, by the way, let's go back to the multiples. RV for the bank here. And then tell me about this bank, Australia and New Zealand Bank, right? Which is one of the large banks in Australia. I know very little about them. I'm sure you guys, many of you probably never even heard of them before. And that's not the point. It doesn't matter if we know anything about them. What do we know about them? Look at their price to book. Positive spread. So that's the point. I know that Sumitomo Bank in Japan has a negative spread, and I know that Australia New Zealand Bank has a positive spread. All right. Now, here's another interesting inference that I could make. What's their PE for ANZ Bank, Australia New Zealand Bank? What's their PE? 11. What is Sumitomo's PE? 8. So they're trading at a premium for earnings. Why? Probably because they have a positive spread, so people are more willing to pay for those earnings than somebody with a negative spread. Think back to what we were talking about with PE. Right? If I go back to PE, what would be a lower PE? Potentially the negative spread leads to a lower PE. What's a higher PE? Higher spread, positive spread. Suddenly growth becomes valuable. So let's talk about growth, by the way. If I go back to Sumitomo, and I look at the EEO, and I look at their expected growth. So right now, the growth, and we'll use sales as a proxy, 1%, 2%, 2%. What's going to be the impact of that growth on their multiple and their value? For Sumitomo, yes? Exactly. So that's why this is also important. When I'm growing that negative spread, as an investor, I'm not going to see as much upside in this stock. What about ANZ? If I go to Australia New Zealand Bank, see, this is them, and I look at their growth expectation, they're expected to grow 11%, 6%, 5%, 4%. Well, they're growing a positive spread. That's going to be more valuable. That's, by the way, why they're trading at a higher PE. So that's the point. Sumitomo is growing a negative spread in a very competitive market in Japan. ANZ, the Australian market, is actually a very protected market. It's got very few banks. Customers have very little choice. And as a result, those banks make a lot of money. And so as a result, their growth is extremely profitable. Where even though in Japan there's like four mega banks, the problem is there's a lot of small, mid-sized banks, kind of like the U.S. And it's a much more competitive marketplace. All right, so that's what you're actually seeing. And by the way, we didn't have to do any analysis to do this. It's right there in the multiples. This is what you're going to start to see in the multiples. Okay, so here's the PB. The good news about the price to book is it's the most clean ratio for telling you about the spread. The bad news about the price to book is it's also one of the dirtiest ratios that's susceptible to accounting distortions. So when price to book is clean, it's great. When price to book is dirty, it makes the analysis flawed, and you have to figure out whether price to book is clean or dirty. Here's what I mean by this. Lockheed Martin, LMT US Equity, RV, same template. Price to book of Lockheed Martin's 24. In fact, Boeing is almost 15. All right? Here's a challenge. Does Lockheed Martin have a positive spread? Looks like it, but 24 seems like a giant spread, gigantic. So here's the deal. Lockheed Martin's a very old company, and they have a lot of old employees. And Lockheed Martin also has a big pension. Now, they're starting to end their pension, but a lot of old employees and retired employees have a pension, which means the company is responsible for their liabilities, but the company is also responsible for managing the pension assets, and they have to match the assets against the liabilities. So here's what happened. 2008, the stock market went down to like Dow 6500. All those pension assets lost about one-third in value. So what the accountants made them do, in order to balance out their balance sheet, they said the assets lost value in their pension assets, so they had to take a corresponding equity write-off, and they wrote off a bunch of equity in the T accounts. So then, stock market went from 6,500 to, I don't know, what's it today, 17,000 and something? So the stock market's gone up dramatically. So the pension assets have gone up dramatically, but the accounts don't let you write it up. So the accounts do now let you mark to market the value of your pension assets. They keep it at book value. Now, when they lose value, they write it down, but they don't write it back up. So that's Lockheed Martin. They wiped out a bunch of equity. Boeing's the same thing, because this industry has a lot of pension assets. But then now that these pension assets are more valuable, it's not reflected on their balance sheets, so they have distorted price to books. That's what I mean by a dirty price to book. So I can't look at the price to book and say that tells me about the spread, because it's just an accounting distortion that says they have almost no equity, so their value looks really good. So that leads to the next ratio. It's called the PEG ratio, P-E-G. Right? P-E-G is the price to earnings ratio divided by the growth rate. Okay. So what does the PEG ratio tells me? The PEG ratio tells me how much am I willing to pay for a unit of growth. Okay. Now, think back to the key value drivers. What we said in the first week of class and in the reading is that the reason that you would pay more for growth is what? Why would I pay more for growth? I have more what? More spread. So if I have more spread, I'm going to pay more for the growth. So here's the point. The PEG ratio normalizes the growth amongst companies, growth and earnings. So it says, what am I willing to pay for a unit of growth and earnings? The reason I would pay more for growth and earnings is because they're going to get better spread, better ROIC. So that's the other nice thing about the PEG ratio, is the PEG ratio is also a clear indicator of future ROIC. And that's the general idea. If my PEG is less than one, I'm paying less than a dollar for a dollar of earnings. That must not be very value-creating earnings. If my PEG is above one, I'm paying more than a dollar for a dollar of earnings, right? So let's look at Lockheed Martin. Their PEG is 2.49, which means for every dollar of earnings, it turns into $2.49 of value. The industry, a dollar of earnings, is at 2.06. I'm looking here at the market cap weighted average. What can we say about Lockheed Martin's expected spread? Who has the higher spread? Lockheed Martin or the industry? Lockheed Martin. So that's the next point. Not only do I know Lockheed Martin has a positive spread, but I also know that their spread is higher than their industry peers. Which also explains why their price to book is higher, but I happen to know that that price to book is distorted, so I couldn't have seen it just alone, but it's nice to put the two together to tell that story. And that's why sometimes with these ratios, we'll have to triangulate. Sometimes they'll tell us conflicting stories. And I'm telling you, when there's a conflict, the PEG typically, not always, but typically, is the one that you'll lean on to give you more of the story, because it's less sensitive to distortions than the than the price-to-book multiple. However, PEG is still based on net income, and net income still has flaws because it's related to accounting. So none of these are perfect, but that's what I'm saying is this is part of your next homework assignment. Is I will give you a company, and you're going to tell me by these ratios, before you even look at the rest of the company, whether they have a positive spread and how it relates to the rest of the industry. And it's right there. Now that you know where to look, you'll quickly be able to tell me that. Right? So here's the next thing I'm going to add into the mix, which is the estimated long-term growth rate. Now, the best estimated long-term growth rate is growth in earnings per share. In our model, we use something called CVG. They're not the same growth. CVG is the perpetuity growth of cash flow. The best LTG is the five-year growth rate in earnings per share. That does not equal perpetual cash flow. But here's the assumption we're going to make, that they're directionally correlated. Meaning if you're growing your earnings faster, you're probably going to be growing your cash profits faster. Okay? So therefore, they won't tell us one-to-one what the G should be, but if my earnings growth is faster, then my cash flow growth should be faster, and I should become more valuable. Okay? So that's the way we're going to use the long-term growth rate, is to give us directionality of the growth relative to the peers. So let's go back to CAT. And again, RV, looking at my template. So I want you to look at CAT, and I want you to look at Joy Global. Because Nicole said that Joy was one of CAT's competitors. They also make constructions, cranes, big equipment. Okay? Now, which company, or what can we say? We'll start out with the PEG and the price to book. What can we say about those two companies based on PEG and price to book? CAT, Joy Global. How can you tell? Sorry, just be specific so we make sure everybody understands how you drew that conclusion. And?
And the peg ratio shows, well, Caterpillar's peg ratio is at 1.74 compared to Joy's
0.65. So let's talk about spreads. So therefore, spread at Caterpillar is?
A lot more positive than Joy.
I don't think it's the word a lot more. I think the spread at Cat is positive. I think at Joy Global, I think the spread is actually negative. Right? And the reason I think Joy Global's spread is negative is because their price to book is 0.61 and their PEG is 0.65. So that's the point. For every dollar of equity, they're only worth 61 cents. They have negative NPV there. For every dollar of growth, the growth of a dollar of earnings is only worth 65 cents of market value. So therefore, Joy Global probably has a negative spread, where CAT has a positive spread. Right? Now, here's the next thing. Joy Global's growing faster. Their growth in earnings is 14.5%. CAT's growth is only expected to be 9%. However, let's talk about PE, right? Or actually, sorry, let's talk about EV to EBITDA. Start with EV to EBITDA, because that's a key multiple in the industry. EV to EBITDA at CAT is 7.87. EV to EBITDA at Joy Global is 8.01. Very close. They're both right around 8 times EV to EBITDA, right? Why? Why do they basically have the same value of EBITDA despite the fact that CAT has a positive spread and Joy has a negative spread? What does the market allow us to say that gets us there? Who's growing faster? How do I grow faster and end up with the same multiple? How do I grow faster and end up with the same multiple? I have to have a lower spread. Does everybody see that? Because if multiple equals growth and spread, and I'm growing faster and end up with the same multiple, the only way that happens is if I have a lower spread. So when I actually look at the trading multiple of EV to EBITDA, then it reinforces what we just concluded with the PEG and the price to book. Right? Same thing. How at Caterpillar, if I'm growing slower than my peers, do I end up creating just as much value? People must feel my growth is more valuable, therefore they're paying more for it because I have a higher ROIC, higher spread. Reinforcing. I'm seeing it across these three ratios as I'm tying my story together. Does everybody see that? Yes. What I was looking at was the far right column of the best LTG EPS. I was using that as the proxy for the growth rate. Right? Now, this is more advanced. Sorry, just you got to deal with the real world. Look at the EV to EBITs. EV to EBIT of CAT is 16.56. EV to EBIT of Joy Global is 12.42. I pay less for the EB to EBIT of Joy versus CAT, right? Back to the point, if I grow at a lower spread, then I'm probably going to have less value. I'm going to destroy value over time, okay? So what it really says, because one of the big differences between EBITDA and EBIT is what? What's the difference between EBITDA and EBIT? Depreciation. So depreciation is a proxy for the capital investment. So that's the point. If I make a lot of capital investment and I don't earn a good return on it, it's going to be worth even less. So that's the point. The EV to EBIT is going to be a lot lower because what people are saying is that depreciation, which is a proxy for the CapEx, is not going to be as nearly as valuable as Joy Global because they have lower return on investment. Now, that's a more advanced nuance, but again, something, and notice, we didn't dig into a single 10K financial statement to draw these conclusions. Because we now have a good understanding when we get there of what we're going to start to see. And this is what I want you guys to be able to do as part of your next homework assignment, just so you know. Questions about any of what we just did so far? So, let's go back. PowerPoint. Enterprise value to EBIT. What is the formula for enterprise value to EBIT? We start with the key value drivers. We divide the key value drivers. NOPLAT is EBIT times 1 minus the tax rate. Divide both sides by EBIT, value to EBIT, and we get 1 minus the tax rate times 1 minus growth, ROIC, WACC, and G. We can actually create an enterprise value to EBIT multiple if we knew these numbers. But here's the point. This was the key value drivers, which we use for PE. This is what we use for enterprise value to EBIT. What's new that jumps out at you that says that there's now five variables that can be sensitive to enterprise value to EBIT? So there's one more thing that's now important to enterprise value to EBIT. Tax rate. So now tax rate matters. So when I look at enterprise value to EBIT, one thing that could also be changing the enterprise value to EBIT between Joy and CAT could be different tax rates. Right? Because one of the assumptions is, do they have the same tax rate? Maybe they don't. So here's what I'm going to do with our template. I'm going to go back to our template, and I'm going to add a column, EFF, effective tax rate, for, and I'll use last year. And I hope that there's not any accounting distortions in the last year. So there's the tax rates for the last year for both these companies. And again, I'll save my template. Because I want to keep that. But here's the point. What's the tax rate for Joy Global? 28%. What's the tax rate for CAT? 27%. I don't think tax rate explains the difference in enterprise value to EBIT. So I go back to what I originally said. I think the real difference in enterprise value to EBIT is Joy Global has a lower spread. Probably a negative spread. And therefore, all that extra growth is not nearly as valuable. Now, why might that matter if I'm a sell-side analyst? Well, let's think about this. If we're in a cyclical downturn, right? Now go back to how Morgan Stanley and some of the other analysts are valuing these companies. What she said is, when I have a peak of the cycle, I use a certain PE or certain multiple, and when I'm at the trough, I use a different multiple, right? And that's the point. We're at a trough, right? So the growths are lower, the returns are lower, the margins are lower, and as a result, they're going to have lower PEs, right? But now let's think about this. CAT's in a cyclical business. We see more sales. Which company, Joy or CAT, is probably going to do better if we see more sales? Who do I want to bet on, given the analysis we did, if we see an uptick in sales in the construction industry? Yeah?
CAT, because they have a higher spread.
Exactly. So that's the point. Take that spread, grow it, and they're going to be much more valuable going forward than Joy Global. So that's the next thing that I know as an analyst. Because even though they might have the same enterprise value to EBITDA multiple, what's behind that is the fact that CAT doesn't have the growth right now, but they have a better engine. And when I put that engine into more growth, they are going to get a lot more valuable than Joy, which is already growing faster, but doesn't have the underlying engine. That doesn't mean that Joy can't fix its engine, but I'm going to be more biased to give CAT credit for the fact that they already have a good model, and when they grow it, they're going to be more valuable. So CAT, to me, has more upside than Joy Global in the next cycle. And that could influence a buy versus a hold. Yes?
So for when you look at the tax rate, what's like an example where maybe a tax rate might explain that?
Well, I mean, take a company like Apple or Google. Their tax rate is around 15%. because they're channeling all their profits through Europe, particularly Ireland, to lower their tax bills. Versus take another company like Netflix or some of the other tech companies, or like a LinkedIn or whatever, that's not doing that. They have mostly U.S. sales. They don't have international sales to get the lower tax rate. That's going to directly affect their valuations. So, you know, a Twitter, LinkedIn is going to be penalized because they're paying 35% and the other companies are paying 15%. So you're going to get a better multiple just because you're getting lower taxes. And that will help Google's multiple, just as an example, versus a U.S. only company. Right? So that's why international companies could actually have better multiples, because they're paying lower taxes than U.S. companies, because it's just one of the influencing factors. Right? And by the way, 20% lower tax rate, 20% higher multiple. It's just cash flow. All right, back to this. Final ratio I want to talk about, because we skipped one, was enterprise value to sales. And here's the key. Enterprise value to sales or revenue can be gotten to by the key value driver formula. And again, it's right out of the book. But here's the idea. Key value driver formula on the top, NOPLAT, or NOPAT, which is revenue times EBIT times 1 minus tax rate over revenue. Divide both sides by revenue, and I get basically my margin here divided by 1 minus the tax rate times all this other stuff. Well, all this other stuff, 1 minus the tax rate and all this other stuff, is EV to EBIT. So basically, enterprise value to sales is my margin, my EBIT margin, EBIT divided by sales, times the enterprise value to EBIT formula. So two things about enterprise value to sales. Number one, enterprise value to sales is the cleanest look at a company's margin. If you have a higher EV to sales, you most likely have a higher margin. If you have a lower EV to sales, you have a lower margin. That's the point. EV to sales, how much am I going to pay for your sales? How much value comes out of your sales? What makes your sales more valuable? You make more money when you sell more stuff. Now, here's the other thing. If I divide estimated margin, remember, all of these are forward-looking estimates. So this is not the margin today. This is the estimated margin in the future. All right? This is not the ROIC today. This is the ROIC expectation in the future. This is not the growth today. This is the growth expectation for the future. But here's the point. My estimated margin for the future is my EV to sales divided by my EV to EBIT. That gets me an estimate of my margin. So let's go back. I come back to CAT. All right, I have my template saved. Output, Excel. Every time you output, you're going to have a security warning because Bloomberg exports it as an XML file, which Microsoft says could be a security risk. So when you save it, save as, make sure that you save it as an Excel template as opposed to an XML file. So here's my CAT comps. So I'll save it on my computer, my downloads folder. Close out of this. All right. Now, here's the thing. This is just that screen saved for CAT, which is this file. And I'll make this a little bit bigger so it's easier to see. But here's the point. Enterprise value to sales equals expected EBIT margin times EV to EBIT. So I don't really care about market cap in this field. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to change this to estimated margin. So estimated margin equals enterprise value to sales divided by enterprise value to EBIT. So right now, the average company on this list is expected to have a going margin of a little under 9%. And if I copy and paste this down, the average margin of CAT is expected to be 6.6%. So what I'm telling you is based on the trading multiples today, people are trading CAT as if it has an approximate 7% operating margin going forward. That's what the trading multiples suggest. I didn't look up their 10K, I didn't look up their balance sheet, I didn't look up anything, but I know that. So what do I know about CAT? I know that their margin's a little under 7%. I know that they're growing a little bit slower than some of their bigger peers. I know they have a better spread than some of their bigger peers. And I know that they're going to have more upside if the growth actually returns. Now, I'm ready to dig in. Okay? This is what you have to do on Monday for the company that I'm going to give you in just a few minutes. And by the way, if you're a group project. All right? And this is where multiples get more sophisticated than what you've learned in the past. right? And it's based on the theory that's behind this. And that's the point. Multiples are a result of the theory. We're working backwards to understand and explain what can drive the multiples and what makes it higher. So when I told you that I was at LyondellBasell, and I told you that the guy who's their number two investor, Fidelity, was sitting in front of their senior leadership team, and he had a sheet of paper in his hand, and he was trying to figure out whether or not he wants to buy, sell, or hold LyondellBasell in his own portfolio, and he had it all down to a piece of paper in his hand, now you have an appreciation for why he could have done that. Because what he needed to know is, what's my tax rate? What's my level of growth? What's my level of return in my spreadsheet? That tells me what the multiples could be at different taxes, different growths, different returns. And so all he has to know is, give me guidance as to what your growth and return is going to be. I kind of know your tax rate, and I know what multiple you're going to trade at. And then I can look at the actual trading multiple in the marketplace, and then I'll make a decision if I buy, sell, or hold you. And what he basically said is, I see that the multiples that I'm viewing of the firm are better, higher than what you're actually trading at. Therefore, I want to add more of you to my portfolio. Now, the guy could be wrong, because we're still predicting the future about what the expected growth and return is. But that's the idea of how these people use multiples in their valuation. That's the same thing. What Morgan Stanley was listening to in the conference call last week for Kat is Nicole, when she went back and got her model, she's trying to get an understanding of, what's the growth rate going to be? What's the margins going to be? How much are you investing? I can figure out my return on investment. She then put it into, and you can see her valuation model, and that's where they came up with the trading multiples, and they can compare that to the trading multiples that they actually see for Kat to decide buy, sell, hold. And her conclusion was the trading multiples for CAT look in the hold category based on the data that she's putting into her model, so she doesn't see them as having as much upside. So again, we have different points of view out the future, but that's where we can use multiple analysis to help us do valuation. Okay? All right. In the interest of time, I need to move on to the second half of your assignment. I'm going to do an example here using Apple, because they just reported earnings yesterday. So the second part of your assignment is you're going to have to do, for a company that I give you, you're going to have to do a model, an as-is, a bull case, and a bear case, and you're going to also have to do, for that company, your target stock price, and write out your rationale as why. And then you're going to do the multiple analysis for that company as well. So that's your Monday assignment that's coming up. So let me talk to you about how we use the model we did for CAT on Monday, and we put the data for another company in there to reuse the model to do the valuation. So in order to do that, save this comps file. What I'm going to do next is I'm going to go here to Monday, and I'm going to go to our as-is file. So this was the as-is valuation that I did on the YouTube video on Monday. Okay. So the next thing I'm going to do for CAT is I'm going to save it as a different name. So file, save as, and I'm going to call this, instead of cat, I'm going to call this Apple, A-P-P-L, as is. And I'm going to save this in a folder called Apple on my computer. All right, so let's talk about how we update this model for Apple. So I'll go back to Bloomberg. Well, I got to go to Apple, U.S. equity, and I'll see that right now they're trading at about 118 a share. Okay, obviously, the market liked what they heard yesterday with their earnings release. So how do we update this model? Well, first, I need to go to the FA section. And just like you did for one of your homework assignments, where you created a template that you exported, which I called model for Komatsu, you're going to go to that model template or whatever you called it, and making sure that you're exporting six periods of no extra fields, of ascending data, of values, which we had already done in the previous assignment, basically output to Excel that template. So when you do, that will get you Apple's data for the last 6 years. And by the way, fiscal 2015 was reported yesterday for the year at Apple ending September 26th. And by the way, notice that within 24 hours, it's already here on Bloomberg. Okay, so these are based on the press release last night. All the data for their year is right here in Bloomberg. It's already there. Okay, nice, another nice feature using something like Bloomberg. So again, back to this. Save this as Excel somewhere where you can find it. So Excel, and I'll call this Apple data. I had done this in a previous class. That's why the file's there. Very important, because Excel's going to choke on the export because Excel doesn't know how to handle dash dashes. So when Bloomberg is missing a data field or has a zero, it puts in dash dash. I don't know why. I don't know how to stop it from doing that. So one additional step, edit, replace. So find, which you can use. Where is find? File. Nope. Sorry. I'm a Mac user. So let me quit out of this. Is it just Control F? All right, use Control F. Or if you have a Mac, then you can go here and hit Find, File, Edit, Edit, Find, Replace. All right, and I want to search for dash dash. So I can just type in dash dash, replace with zero, replace all, and it'll just replace my dash dashes with zeros. Because like I said, if you put in dash dashes into Excel, it'll just give you errors when it tries to use that in a formula. So I'll save that file. Now, next piece. When I go to my model for cat, I go to the model data tab. What I want to do is I want to replace cell for cell, the Apple data with the cat data. Or sorry, the cat data with the Apple data. So I go back to Apple. I select the whole tab. I copy the whole tab. I go to the cat model, which is now the Apple model. I select the whole model data tab. Right click, paste special values. Now you don't want to copy paste, you want to paste special values. And here's why. If you copy paste, it might make a reference to that old spreadsheet, and every time you open the file, it'll say, where's that other spreadsheet? All right, Excel will be friendly like that and you'll hate it. So if you just want to copy the numbers, copy, paste special values. There's no links to external spreadsheets. So just save you a little bit of time and hassle later. All right, but again, cell for cell replacement, select the tab, replace the tab. Then go to the assumptions. We got to start updating the assumptions data. First thing we notice about Apple is they just reported their fiscal 2015 just ended. So now the last reported year for Apple is no longer 2014, it's 2015. So in our model, 2015. The WACC. Their WACC is probably different than CAT's WACC. So we got to update it. So let's go back to Apple. Type in WACC. Their WACC right now is 8.9%. So I'll save this as a screenshot. Apple WACC. Save. Replace. Put 8.9% in my model. All right. Growth we'll talk about later. We'll leave it at 3% for now. Shares outstanding. They have different shares outstanding. DES. Their shares outstanding, 5,702.7 million. A lot more shares than CAT. Save screen, Apple, DES. So, 5702.7. 5702.7. Right? Now, sales off the EEO, expectations are different. EEO. Again, I want annual data. Don't put in the quarterly data. File, save as. Apple EEO. So I want their, again, estimates for annual data for 2016, 2017, because the forward years have changed for Apple. Forward year one, forward year two. So these numbers get pretty staggering. Sales next year, $245.142 billion. Sales in 2017, $257.541 billion. 257,541. EBITDA next year, $84,239 billion of EBITDA. 84,239. Apple will have more EBITDA than Google will have sales next year, or Alphabet. 2017 EBITDA, $86,606. $86,606 billion. Okay, so we put in those staggering numbers, and then we go to our ratios. Now here's what's key. We still don't want to muck around with these growth and EBITDA forecasts, but we were playing around with CAT, so I want to reset them. Equals previous year, copy and paste. Margins equals previous year, Because if I don't, the share price will be wacky, copy and paste. And if I changed anything else, I want to update it. So, for example, tax rate, which I didn't change, I might want to update. But regardless, here's my tax rate. I'm okay with that. Here's the next 2 years EBITDA and growth. Here's my forecasted share price, 187. And the answer is I got to get to 118 to do my as-is. Same process we did for CAT. So one of the things I could do very quickly is if I go back to EEO, I could look at growth. And I can see by 2018, Apple's growth is expected to fall to like 2%. Okay, so basically 2%. Well, now I'm down to 171, right? And eventually maybe 1%, I don't know. So the point is Apple's probably expecting a fall in margins. Well, they were down as low as 29.8 a few years ago. But here's the other key. RV. Output, Excel, cancel. Custom, 443 multiples. Output, Excel. Margin equals EV to sales divided by EV to EBIT. The industry's margin, their peers that are on this list, is around 15%. Apple's estimated margin going forward is around 29%. So here's the point. Market's expecting this to fall to 28.9. So I already know that the way I'm going to get down to 117 is these EBITDA margins are too high. Because that's going to be, that is 28.9. So I'm really close to the operating margin. So actually, the market's not expecting Apple to keep growing. They're eventually going to expect Apple to shrink. Right, because this is the operating margins that they're using, so therefore growth is going to start turning negative. So 2, 0, -2, -0.02, and then I go to my assumptions and my CVG 1, maybe called no growth long term, and I'm very close. I'm at 125 plus or minus a little bit, so maybe the growth is negative 3%, something like that, -5%. And here, maybe my CVG is -1. I don't know, maybe somewhere in there, and I'm close to the current stock price. But that's the point. This is how I use the multiples to help me with the margins, which help me with the growth rate for Apple. Right? And I guess what I'm saying is, and this is where it's different. Most of the time I'd say companies are going to expect it to grow with the economy. And I think what people are saying is, Apple sold something like 80 million iPhones, that's probably not going to keep up, right? So Apple's more about they're just getting so many sales that they're just not going to be able to keep that level of sales at that price up with one product forever. And at some point, the market is not expecting, it's not that Apple's not going to grow, it's just they've grown so fast that it's just not sustainable to have that level of size, given the size of the market and what they're expecting to have with the market going forward. I think that's the way people are pricing Apple. And they don't see the next big thing because, unfortunately, what happened to Apple is iPad sales continue to plummet. Nobody's buying the watch. Okay, and, unfortunately, Apple Pay is not taking off yet. So Apple is still the iPhone. Right, and eventually the iPhone, people aren't going to pay $750 for iPhones anymore. Right, the prices are going to come down. And they're not going to sell 80 million iPhones a year. Right, so at that point, when the market matures, I think the market's saying Apple's going to shrink. So it's not that the market's going to shrink. It's just that they're so outsized towards the market, they're going to look like most of their peers, which, oh, by the way, have a 14% margin, not a 29% margin. So that's the point. Eventually, they're going to have lower sales and lower margins. Right now, they're assuming they got the margins. It could be lower sales. But that's the point. That's how they're 117. That's the as-is. It doesn't mean you can agree with that. If you think they're going to do better, you can come up with a bull case and a bear case, which has a different price for Apple. But what I really wanted to show you is this is how you update the model, and this is how you start to make the changes. Questions about any of that? Yes?
Should our target price be 103?
Well, the as-is should always be very close to the current price. So the target price could be different than your bull bearer as-is. So I'm just saying, what I want you to do, and this is what Nicole was suggesting, I think it's a great exercise, is just think through the process of what would cause upside, what would cause downside, and then you can come up with a specific target price, which is different than the bull case, but at least it puts you into the bull or bear frame, or the it's actually fairly priced frame. Right? And so that's the point for me. For Apple, I actually think Apple's fairly priced. Right? And I'll jump to a couple conclusions, but my reason for that is I don't think that the sales are going to drop off dramatically, but I think the margins are going to start to come down because nobody is going to earn double the margins of their peers for that long before competition, which is competition for Android. I mean, Android is good. So why am I going to keep paying these giant premiums if the competitors are a lot cheaper? Because Google's now got an Android phone for $500. It's actually pretty darn good with Marshmallow on it. Right? I'm still an Apple user. I'm not going to switch, but it's going to put pressure on Apple. And I think that's what they should be worried about. So I just don't see a lot more upside. And you're going to see that there's upside built in here. So long story short, here's your assignment for Monday. I want to pull this right out of the headlines. 2 weeks ago, we were talking about the death of a company and how this company was in a death spiral. It wasn't doing well, and it wasn't going to perform well. And last week, they reported earnings, and suddenly, it's a renaissance. How great this company is. Look at how well it's doing. Now's the time to jump in. And I don't know if this is real or if this is just a short-term blip, and I want you guys to figure it out for me. So the company is McDonald's. Okay, so last week when McDonald's reported, the first time in a couple years, increase in same-store sales, their stock price has been rocketing again, right, after years of falling down. And so that's the point. Is this real? Is this now the time to jump in on McDonald's? They're an undervalued company and it's a buy? Is this just a blip and this is just not a really sustainable thing? So I want you to evaluate McDonald's. So here's what you're going to do. You're going to do a minimum of 500-word paper. This is individual. It's going to be due on Monday. I'm going to change the grading because this is going to be a super assignment worth 4 points of your semester grade instead of 2 points. So it's going to be a double assignment, right? Minimum of 500 words. Approximately 250 words is the multiples, okay? So you're going to pull the multiples for McDonald's and its peers, just like we did, Bloomberg peers, right? Using, and this has been recorded on video, so you can look at the video, but look at McDonald's, do the multiples, try and figure out relative to the average, so I'll just keep it average of their peers. So multiples tell you if they have a higher or lower spread, and more importantly, what is their estimated margin going forward. Then do the valuation. Do the as-is to a current stock price of McDonald's, depending on the day that you do it. Do your bull case, do your bear case, come up with your target price, and your buy-sell-hold recommendation. Second 250 words, and again, this is a target. You got to do minimum 500. You'll probably do more. The second 250 words is basically how did you come up with those assumptions for each of the cases and why did you choose the final valuation that you did? So explain your methodology for coming up with the assumptions, right? By the way, this is exactly what you're going to have to do for your group project. So this is the dry run. You're just doing this individually, right? Now, you can talk with your peers to help you, but you have to individually write it up. You have to individually get your own data. You have to individually create models. No sharing of models, right? And again, you're welcome to look at the video, which I've just recorded and I will post online, including the templates I exported for Apple as a proxy, but your company is McDonald's, right? I haven't posted this yet because the next two classes, I don't want them doing the assignment during class, but after the next two classes, I will post this online. This is due Monday, 10 a.m. for all sections. We'll discuss this in class. Have a great and safe, happy Halloween. See everybody on Monday.
So right at that, like, if you're just going to take it here, we just show up. We don't have to like, sign up or anything. We just show up.
Sorry. Well, actually, you do have to sign up. So you have to go to that link. Did I talk about this in this class? I thought I did.
Well, was that for the if you want to take it at home?
If you want to take it at home, you don't have to sign up. Just click on the link so I can code take it. The register is for taking the class because there's only so many people that can fit in this room.
Okay.
And because it's now being advertised school-wide, if too many people show up, they'll start turning people away.
Okay, so
register just to make sure that you have a slot so that you're guaranteed to be able to take it in this room. I don't think we're going to have more than 45 people in this room. But on the off chance we do, I just hate for one of my students to be told, no, you can't come out.
Okay.
So that's what the register's for.
Right,
yep.
Hey, professor.
Yep.
I'm actually pitching a stock tomorrow.